Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Ed Park, and today we're doing an Ask Me Anything webinar. I always start with a disclaimer saying that, of course, the use of exosomes has not been approved by the FDA for any treatment or prevention of disease. This video is for educational purposes only. It's not an advertisement for exosomes, and anecdotes are not scientific proof, but we can go into anecdotes and discuss those if the audience so wishes. By way of review, exosomes are not cells. Exosomes are anywhere from 1/200th to 1/500th the diameter. So they're how the cells communicate with each other. Inside them are contained mRNA, basically two types, signaling mRNA, meaning to the blueprints to create proteins, and blocking mRNA called microRNA, which gum up the specific translation, transcription of proteins. They also have some lipids, perhaps some DNA, and some proteins, definitely. So they're little instruction, little kind of cookbook things that cells send to each other. Now, they're about 100 nanometers in diameter, and they are not cells. They don't have the reproductive machinery. They don't have the energy-producing machinery. So again, they're just the passive messages. They don't have self-antigens, at least the ones that we use, so they don't instigate any immune reaction, and they are not readily rejected. Those three antigens are to my left. In contrast, there are other kinds of microvesicles. The bigger ones tend to be just degenerated cells and apoptotic bodies, but there are other cells that are not made by the Golgi apparatus, not made to be messages. So the premise of what we're doing is that, well, when your body is regenerating, it's doing this thing where it sends out mesenchymal stem cells, which produce exosomes, which teach the local stem cells how to be young again, just like in that classic movie Cocoon. So even though your cells are kind of not doing so great, they're phoning it in, they may have been damaged from overcopying, replicative senescence, we call it, and they may be silenced in terms of gene expression from epigenetics, or methylation, we call it. Even old cells can sometimes be stimulated to be in the mood to reproduce and regenerate. And that's the premise of what we're doing. I refer you to Arnold Kaplan's lectures, who is the father of the MSC stem cell. One thing that people always ask when they do their due diligence, they go on the internet, there's a bunch of people promoting this or that. My experience is limited, but it's quite extensive with one brand. Here is a lecture I did with the people from the brand they use, Chimera Labs, and they did an in-house, albeit, you know, perhaps biased study, but they showed that the RNA concentration, in other words, the potency, was very, very different among their competitors. So you may not be comparing apples to apples at all when you talk about, especially particles, because you can turn, if you go to this webinar, you'll see you could turn up the resolution, the gain, and say you have as many particles as you want simply by doing that. One thing we touched upon in the last lecture I did about a month ago was the value equation. And if you want to learn more about the clinical value, go to ExoWeb 25 about repeat injections, 26 best cases, 27 unhappy patients. It's very important to understand why people are unhappy. Either it wasn't enough or it was too expensive or they feel it wasn't a good value. I think the efficacy of stem cells, from what I hear, and I do interact with patients, it varies. Some people say it worked for a while. Other people have good results, but it's variable. I think the predictable effects of exosomes is a little bit higher, but again, I'm not extensively versed in stem cell use. Safety-wise, definitely favors exosomes or autologous, but not many people have. Very few people, in fact, have their own stored stem cells that they can legally expand and have shipped to them. So I think safety-wise, exosomes are much better because you're not getting someone else's cells that will be rejected or become microchimeric. In other words, you become a mosaic species. The cost is also higher for stem cells, starting around five and up 1,000. So it's not cheap. This is just a screenshot of something I did this morning. It's if you go to my website, that's a misspelling. It's Recharge Biomedical not recharGray, biomedical.com. /exosome_shortlinks.xlsx. You can always download the latest version of my exosome educational materials. And on the left column are 32 blogs I did in the first year and a half, arranging the wide number of subjects. And then I sort of reiterated and used live testimonial to do live webinars while I was in Hawaii and several here in LA now that I've moved. And then on the right column are the first 9 foundational lectures. This is really long-form, 40-minute lectures on the basics that people would have questions about. So anytime in the future, if you spell it right, unlike me, you can go to rechargebiomedical.com and download the latest version of everything that I've produced in this regard. So since we have a couple of participants here, why don't we open it up to questions? You can type them in, or I can unmute you as well. And you can ask me anything. All right, Dr. Blanton is a small animal veterinarian in Ventura. And she is going to regale us with a question.
Yeah, my question is, when you get an IV injection of these exosomes, does it simply go to where it is needed, or how does that work? I think I was more up on the technology of this a year ago, but it's been a while since I've actually read anything about it.
That's an excellent question. And so it's kind of like putting food coloring in a swimming pool. It'll go everywhere, yeah, but in small amounts.
Yeah.
Interesting thing, I had a patient who fell from a horse in Mexico. And if someone is chronically injured, her 5 broken vertebrae probably would have benefited from intraepidural injection.
Uh-huh.
But since she was in such acute pain, she was taking round-the-clock Percocet. So there was already inflammation. And as you know, when there's inflammation, the blood supply, the immune system and surveillance, the cleaning up of the debris of the cells, it's all going there anyway. So that's nature's way of targeting. So if you have an acute injury, then it's all going to go to the right place preferentially. Of course, these are not tracking devices. The first thing they encounter, they'll bind to and possibly release into. But surprisingly, after just a couple of weeks of an IV injection, whereas I had thought maybe she needed an epidural, she said, "Oh, the pain is gone. I'm back in the gym." And her MRI showed 5 crushed vertebrae. So in that instance where there is the hyperemia, the inflammation, then yeah, you're going to get more of a target. Good question.
Okay.
I think it always is better to start it where it's needed and then let it leak out. That's inevitable. Thank you. I'm going to ask a question. Hey, Dr. Park, how come you don't use fluoroscopy? And when do you use ultrasound? Good question, Dr. Park. I get asked this a lot. In our setting, fluoroscopy is the live use of x-rays that the practitioner has to use, lead apron, of course, and in real time, you can guide stuff into spaces. There are times when the spaces are so readily and safely accessible that it adds really no benefit, and of course, you're getting a minute dosing of radiation to the subject, so that's not great. It also involves a facility, a lot of equipment, so that's not in my purview. If I were to do injections, which I never would, at the base of the skull, my colleague Dr. Spiel used to do that, then it's an absolute must because there can be aberrant arteries and a lot of bad stuff in the head and neck that you can damage. And so one exception, I did do a training course in ultrasound guide injections, and so I'm trained in both. But for example, the knee is a common area where we don't use ultrasound because the technique that's taught is to look for the suprapatellar bursa, a fluid-filled thing to inject into, but 15% of the time it doesn't even communicate with the knee, so that's a waste. The knee is very easy to get into if you have the proper technique, and I have a lot of tricks that I use, so it doesn't add anything to me. Also, the shoulder doesn't add anything to me. If we're going to the subacromial bursa, it's very easy to approach from behind, and there's really no anatomy that we can disturb when we approach from behind. If we're going to the hip, in contradistinction, it's very dangerous. You can nick some arteries, veins, and so we have to use a real-time ultrasound, the needle going right into the neck and the head of the the femur, and that's really important. Other times, if we're doing a facet in the spine, we would use an ultrasound just to make sure we're in the exact right spot. But surprisingly, a lot of people think you need an ultrasound to do an epidural injection, not so. It's a very relatively easy technique with loss of resistance to air or saline. And you pretty much know based on the depth and the loss of resistance where you are. So there are times when you don't use an ultrasound. All right, I guess I'm gonna have to power this AMA myself. I'm gonna ask another frequently asked question. Hey, how come company X is providing, you know, 10 times the exosomes for the same price? Well, again, if we go back to ExoWeb or webinar 24, you can find these by tinyurl.com/ExoWeb24. If you look at the section where they talk about turning up the gain, you really, you can say a glass of water has 100 billion exosomes. It's just you're turning up the graininess or the capture of the particles. So to me, in my clinical practice, I've gotten good results. It's not cheap, but the results are good. So I'm not switching ponies in the middle of the race to people that might not have the same level of scientific thoroughness. And so, you know, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. Patients are doing well. Why mess with it? Oh, I'm sorry. Dave had a question. Do you sometimes do nasal injections? Oh, we answered that one. Sorry. Yeah. So the point is, nasal for the brain. My mom has gotten, I think, 5 or 6 now. She's super smart. Now she's negotiating with gangsters, and you know, she's a little bit too much activated. She told me after the first time she wanted to go to medical school. I'm like, Mom, you're going to need a 4-year degree before you go to medical school. So yeah, it's got her. She's driving at 4 in the morning at age 84. So she's a real menace to herself, I think. Dave G asks, what is intrathecal and what does it treat? Intrathecal just means inside the dural sac or the spinal sac where the nerves are. The nerves emerge from the sac and they exit the spine. So the dura is that hard mother, I guess. And that's what encases the brain in the meninges, and it goes down into the spinal column and surrounds it as a sac. So if we do an epidural injection, we're trying to stay out of that. We're trying to get in the space that's epidural, outside the dura. And that's because that's where the ligaments, the cartilage, the bone are being, and the nerves are being bathed. But if we intentionally use a different needle, we can go a tiny bit farther than the epidural and puncture into the cerebral spinal space. And then you get that fluid coming back. That's commonly known as a lumbar tap, because it's in the lumbar region. But the circulation of cerebrospinal fluid is the cushioning and the nourishing and the cleaning out of the central nervous system. So intrathecal just means into the dural sac. Now we're getting in the spirit of an ask me anything. All right, ask me anything. You know, it's something I would probably try. I was just contacted by a chiropractor in Wisconsin, and they wanted to treat somebody for Lou Gehrig's ALS. And I said to him, look, you know, if it was me, I would try it. And he said, same. So, you know, you just don't know how these things work and whether they're going to regenerate. But in conditions of, you know, a neurologic endpoint and rapidly and progressively deteriorating situation, you know, perhaps the risk is mitigated by the potential benefit. Any other questions? You can ask me anything. You have the horse's mouth or the other end here live. Dr. Blanton, my friend said that horses are very telepathic. I think dogs and cats are also very telepathic. What do you think about animal telepathy? I'd love to hear. But maybe.
Yeah, that's the thing. Right.
I guess dogs and little kids are kind of like a little more clairvoyant than stupid adults.
They don't have language standing between them and their reality like we do.
That's a great point. Yeah, I always I always think like consciousness is actually a way to avoid reality. It's actually a way to categorize it and put a filter, a barrier.
Yeah, our rational mind is not the same as reality. It's a tool, and we put much more faith in it, I think, than it deserves.
So. Yeah. I think it could be argued that much like religion is a barrier to a religious experience, at times the consciousness is a way to weed out and filter and not experience life. So if you could see how beautiful the day is, or how clear the air is, or opposite, you know, people often, I think now that they're experiencing some of the entheogenic, hallucinogenic drugs to treat PTSD and depression and anxiety, people are starting to shed those layers of programming and consciousness and trauma. And they're realizing that purpose of, or the experience of being, is much more blissful than originally thought.
Have you read the book by Jill Bolte Taylor, or Jill Taylor Bolte? I'm not sure which way her name goes, about My Stroke of Insight. She's a great. Did you read that?
No. I met her and I heard her lecture once about 10 years ago in Sun Valley. So I do know her shtick. But yeah, she definitely had that catastrophic stroke and subsequent recovery. But yeah, I guess it was all taken away and then slowly introduced back. So I think that provides some interesting insights. But I have a colleague, a friend of mine, who is a trained radiation oncologist, and he's been doing a lot of work with something called ketamine, which is kind of related to PCP. You know ketamine. It's a large animal.
I use it all the time.
Yeah. So I think for people with traumatic PTSD, I think it really helps them, at least for a moment, shed the story and just live in the moment.
Let's hear it for Buddhism.
Buddhism. Love Buddhism. Anyway, there is a question coming across from Dave. Thanks. Dave says, I know a surgeon who was forced to retire early because of spine problems related to bending over patients all day. Well, yeah, absolutely. Can exosomes help regenerate bad spines? I will also ask for a friend who needs knee replacement. Will exosomes work even if it's only bone on bone? Two common questions I get. I mean, bone on bone is all relative. I had a gentleman send me his x-rays. It wasn't literally bone on bone. There really wasn't much left on the medial side of one knee, but it's just a phrase people use. But yeah, when there's very little cartilage, it is kind of bone on bone. And just to back up, the cartilage is made by the subchondral bone. So if the bone itself is healthy, well-vitalized, good vessels, then it can generate cartilage throughout your life, unlike your brake pads, which just get worn down. So yeah, the premise of what we're doing is the exosomes hopefully signal those remaining stem cells to act young again and regenerate cartilage. And yeah, I have seen cartilage regenerate. Does it happen every time? No. And that's part of the unhappy patient thing. You know, I had a gentleman who could afford it, and he did one injection, and you could clearly see that there was more cartilage after the first injection. But he went to see an orthopedic surgeon and got the opinion that, well, we should not do any more x-rays because it's not going to get better, even though it had gotten better since the exosomes. And after the second injection, his symptoms were improved. But again, the doctor said, well, you really need new knees. And so he's getting a knee replacement. Arguably, he could have tried a third injection, and that would have mitigated and allowed him to avoid the surgery. But of course, nothing can be gained from avoiding surgery when you're a surgeon. Speaking of surgeons, yeah, I mean, when I wash dishes and I'm hunched over like this, you know, I do get a back pain. He just needed to have better posture. But yeah, certainly part of aging is this kyphosis, or bending over. And yeah, you know, not all people get better, but if they stick with it, you know, there is some improvement possible. I would say the knees, 70-80% are happy. The back, you know, 60-70. Back is a much more complicated structure. And even when you start relieving some things in the back, other things are exposed. Like I remember I flew out and I treated a gentleman for his quadratus lumborum, and that pain went away in several days and is gone still, but now it's unmasked other problems in his facets, and it turns out he has psoriatic arthritis. So that's often the case. You take away the biggest problem, and then they go, oh, well, my hamstring doesn't hurt, but now my psoas or my piriformis hurts. It's like, I've seen that treating the hips too. So it's often a very complicated thing. Some things are begetting other things. And so it's not easy to do a quick fix on just one part, just like you can't really fix a watch usually just by, well, maybe you can. I don't know about watch. All right, next question. I mean, the short answer is you don't know until you try. And if it gets better, you might want to repeat it. If it gets worse, definitely don't. If there's no change, then don't. That's kind of, it's a very empiric sort of thing when we're practicing clinical medicine with exosomes. One question people often ask is, where do you get the exosomes? I don't get them. They're kept in cold chain, meaning they come on dry ice, minus 109. They're kept in a minus 80 freezer. When I transport them, you always transport them on dry ice. And they come from a baby's placenta that was donated for no money at a C-section sterile procedure about 5 years ago. And every month they take some of those original mesenchymal stem cells from the placenta and they thaw and they do a fresh batch. And I think that's part of the problem with these competitor companies. I don't think they have the manpower or the wherewithal or even the desire to do fresh batches. So you're drinking like 6-month-old milk, 2-year-old milk. The quality control of the brand that I use, every month it's brand new, but it's kind of like that Star Wars Boba Fett clone army. They ask, how old are the stem cells? Well, the stem cells that you wake up from cryosleep, 90% preserved, 90% just like wake up on day zero. So really they're brand new, even though they're 5 years old, if that makes sense, because they've been sleeping for 5 years. So they are day zero, brand new, fresh, young exosomes from young stem cells. Any other questions? You can ask me anything. I feel like there should be an echo there, some kind of sound effect. Any other questions, comments?
Yes, question.
Yes, ma'am.
When you get cartilage regeneration, are you getting hyaline cartilage or are you getting fibrocartilage?
Oh, I don't know. I assume it's hyaline cartilage. Whatever the subchondral bone is meant to generate, it's the same stuff. I don't think it's like dysfunctional or scarred, like type disordered cartilage. But yeah, I think there's phases. As you know from the question, there's phases of cartilage regeneration in the normal healing process. And there is that sort of 3 to 6 week where it's kind of this disordered fibrillin. But you might be getting both in the short term, just like a normal injury and regeneration. But I don't actually know the answer to your question. I think whatever's happening, if you wait 3-4 months, there's just more dark space on the x-ray and the person has no pain. So perhaps it does go through that. I mean, why wouldn't it? That intermediate disordered phase of cartilage. Good question. And if you have questions about that, you can go back to, there's many webinars that discuss it. There's the one on the knees and the one on tendons, types of collagen, types of cartilage that are laid down in different phases of healing and repair. Okay, everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park. Thanks for joining our Ask Me Anything. I guess I could do these periodically, maybe at a better time, maybe better advertised, but I hope that was helpful to you, and I hope to see you in a future webinar or in a treatment setting soon. Thank you very much. Dr. Ed Park signing off.